Marie is with us today. We are so excited. Marie Johnson is an award-winning historian for both graduate and undergraduate work and a local historian of Salina, Kansas. She is going to share with us today some of her research that she has both written about, spoken about, among many other topics that she's also presented on. She's a graduate of Bethany College and is a U.S. Army veteran. And so we are so excited that she's going to share this information with us today. And I am so grateful that you came and joined us. And I cannot wait for my students to get to listen to this in the future, as it will be definitely assigned to them. Okay. All right. So welcome, Marie Johnson.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me. I've got some slides to show you. I'm going to give you a little bit of history about Salina, how African Americans came to Salina. I'll show you a little, some slides, and then I'll go ahead and discuss with you a little bit more. All of my research has been pretty much primary sourced. I had to go to a lot of the elders in the community. A lot of them are retired and live with their families outside of town. I spoke with people in their 90s, 80s. When I first did my research, it was on Robert Caldwell, who was our African-American mayor, the first African-American mayor in 1970. There was only one out of six in the whole United States. And so I started my research on him, and there was like, I looked and went to the library. There's, when you look at the history of Salina, there are no pictures actually of African Americans. It's as if we don't exist. And if you think about it, there's communities all around the United States with small black populations that no one knows anything about. And so Salina, we've got about 50,000 people right now. There's about a 3-4% black population. That's about 1,800 people. It hasn't grown, and actually it's decreasing a little bit. I was talking about teachers that we have. We have a handful of African-American teachers. And so we do need more people of color to just so that the kids can see someone different, so that some kids can see people that look like them, and so that kids that aren't of African American heritage or Hispanic heritage or anything like that can integrate because we are leaders too, and they need to see that. And I think kids are much more brighter than some of us older people, and they see people not necessarily by what they look like on the outside, but they're what they socialize and relate to and such like that. So I'm going to go ahead and get started. Salina was settled in 1858 by Colonel William Phillips. He was actually an abolitionist, and he came down from Washington to Kansas City to make sure that blacks were being able to vote. And so he and some of his friends were going along the Smoky River and found Salina. And before the railroad, the population was less than 50 people. So this picture right here is of the Salvation Army. And the Salvation Army is on the north end of town, and they did quite a bit for African Americans. They still do to this day. It's an open social area. And if you can see, everyone is African American except for the captain of the Salvation Army. And we have some soldiers here, and they're from World War II. Camp Phillips, have you guys heard about Camp Phillips? Okay, well, that was a camp that Roosevelt commandeered or initiated because they needed some place to keep German soldiers. So, and I've got a picture of that when we get down that way. So, African Americans came through on wagon trains, and this is one of the signs that they use, go to Kansas. You can do it for $5. And this is an example of, or is a caravan to Salina. They had to, or not to Salina, to Kansas. Most people were going to Nicodemus, and you guys know about Nicodemus, the black settlement. So that's where most of them were going. And the blacks came in small groups because it was risky for the blacks to settle alone. And they were instrumental in attracting other emancipated blacks, mainly to the state of from Kentucky. Here's some other pictures. This is Salina. This is our first building, 1860. Hotel and store. And this is Oscar DePreez, and he was the first black congressman from a northern state, and that was in Illinois. He was from Salina. So I'm going to tell you about Oscar DePreez. He was one of the early, or the DePreez were one of the earlier, earliest families to settle in Salina, and they came in the 1870s from Florence, Alabama. And Sidney DePreez was a full-blooded Frenchman from Paris. And his wife was the mulatto daughter of Governor Patton of Alabama. So she was in charge of the other slaves on the plantation, and the emancipation was given, she was given considerable property. And then the DePreez were actually ran out of Alabama by the KKK after their lives were threatened, because two of their 16 children, if you can imagine that, how you can have 16 children back then, what, I mean, it just floors me. I think about like Queen Victoria that had 9 children, you know, and this is like before any kind of medications or anything like that. So God bless them. I have one. That was good for me. But so anyway, two of their 16 children threw rocks at a man after he clubbed their dog to death. And so they had to escape. And they wound up in Salina, Kansas. Imagine that. And so Oscar is the grandchild of these people. And he wanted to study law, so he moved to Chicago. And he became a lawyer and a real estate dealer. In 1928, he was elected U.S. House of Representatives. And he was the first one since Reconstruction, and everybody knows about before or Reconstruction, how many African-American mayors there were, congresspeople. We were flourishing, and then Jim Crow came along. And this is Rosalind, 1930, one of the daughters. And you see how I had to find these photos and such from the elders, because there's nowhere you're going to find them in the library. This is Flora. It's his wife. Well, she had to be. She had to look at her standing there with the broom. You know, you had to be tough back then. It's not just African Americans had to be tough. You know. And then in 1893, we actually had a lynching. They just recently memorialized it in Salina. This is the only picture that I found. We had at one time a newsletter called The Black Word Is, and it was hand-typed, and I got hold of a hard copy of it, and that was not easy. And it just gave information about what was going on in the black community, because there was nowhere else that you were going to find that information. So this is Dane Adams. He was, they say he was kind of basically a hoodlum. He had used to fight and stuff a lot. Well, he got into a fight with some white people and got arrested. He actually went to trial, which was a good thing. He was convicted, and then they took him down to the rail station because they were going to take him to the to prison. And so a mob of white people came down and disconnected the caboose, took him off the train, and hung him from the light post. And so he hung there for about 3 days until black people from the community came and took him down. And we don't know where he's buried at. And this is an example. This isn't him. This is just an example of a lynching. And I want you to see the faces. Like, this is like a community having fun. And the hate, you know, pointing the fingers, you know, we don't get it. I don't get it. But that was just what happened.
They didn't see us as people.
No, they didn't. And this is Salina. the businesses that we had on the north end of town. Now today we have two businesses on the north side of town, which is where the African Americans were basically regulated to live. It's also a side of town that has very poor cell service. It has a flooding area. It's very poor. It hasn't been revitalized. You'll see the rest of Salina, they're doing a great job. And then you start headed down that way, and it basically looks the same as it always did. But right now, we have two black businesses, and they're both hair salons. That's all we have. But at one point, this is before the urban renewal. And these are all the businesses that we had down on the north end of town because we had to be self-sufficient. We weren't able to have a physician like Dr. Wilson. We had auto, we had groceries, parlors, smokehouse, contractors, cleaning. We were just self-sufficient. And then, and you guys know about the urban renewal that happened in the 60s when basically the government came through and they razed through the north end of town. So they tore down a lot of the homes. The problem is that a lot of the people that came to Salina, a lot of them were relatives and stuff, and they lived next door to each other, and they had a community. And then when they came through and they tore down the homes, well, we had redlining. So they couldn't purchase homes, especially on the south side of town. And so, and the banks wouldn't give them money anyway, so they ended up having to rent, and that was very difficult because a lot of white people wouldn't rent to them. And so it's just been a struggle. It's still a struggle now. And I know that when we rented, and she doesn't know this, but when we rented, I had my husband, who is Caucasian, go and look at the place and go ahead and rent it. I didn't go with him. So, and I got to tell you this one. So we have a black church that was our main church, and you'll find that in any black community. There's a central place, and that's the church. And when they first, St. John's Baptist, it actually started in 1879. And let me show you some pictures here. This is an example of a dugout of the church. And here's the church. It burned down, actually. It's no longer there, but it was there for years. And so it was purchased from a white Baptist church in 1887, and they had actually moved from West Ash because there was the railroad station. I don't know if you guys are familiar with the railroad and how significant the railroad station was, or the railroad was when it went through Salina. And so the International Harvester Company came to town, and they wanted that lot, so they personally guaranteed that they'd find a new home, and that's what they did. They found it on North 7th, and there was opposition to the, now you wouldn't think there'd be opposition to the church on the north end of town, but there was opposition from, one second here, from Hattie Tutt, a wealthy black woman who lived on North 8th. And she rented a cottage next door to the proposed church and felt it would be impossible to rent to white people if the church moved there because there'd be so many African Americans there. And she actually hired a lawyer to help fight the move, and she lost. But sometimes we can be our own worst enemies. And here's a congregation. Yeah, that's because they have numbers, because on the that's how on the back of the photo it has their names next to there. And then I want to go over the segregation laws in Kansas. It was primarily with education and the state, and I'm sure you guys as historians probably know this stuff, but I'm going to go over it. The state legislator in 1876 enacted a civil rights law. It prohibited discrimination in any state university, college, or other school or public instruction, or in any place of public accommodation or amusement or public conveyance. In 1887, after a wave of 8,000 African Americans from southern states moved to Kansas, the legislator enacted a law giving first-class cities, and that's a city of 15,000 or more, so those are big cities. That's why I think Salina's a big city and we're 50,000. I mean, that's just me. But the authority to establish segregated elementary and junior high schools, specifically separate African-American schools, and this practice continued until 1954. And so Salina schools were integrated until Dunbar was built. So there were actually grade schools that had black students. And if you go to our museum, there's a picture of an old school and there's one black student there. And I was like, wow, there's a black. And then I looked it up. Yeah, there's schools that were integrated. I want to show you Dunbar. Here we go. This is our segregated school from 1922 to 1955. And the reason why it's only 1955 is because once the schools were integrated, there were no more black students and people didn't send their white kids there. So what happened is the kids got to go to school, but they didn't hire the black teachers. And so a lot of times the black teachers were even more educated than their white counterparts because they would have doctorates and such, but all they could do was teach. And so we have a very small black population as far as teachers go, and that has a lot to do with it because this desegregation, it was good, but it didn't help those black teachers. And then in our town, we didn't have another black teacher that was hired until 1964, and he was hired, and that was our mayor, our black mayor, and he was hired at our high school. And that's the mayor right here, and this, he was the principal of Dunbar, and you talk to any of the elders, and they're like, he would knock on their door, tell them their kids were being baby kids. I don't know if you know what that is. It's a badass kid. And so he would go and he'd tell them they weren't coming to school. They weren't doing this, they weren't doing that. It was a family, you know, it was a family community. Let's see here. And let's see, Dunbar was established in 1922 by the Salina Board of Education as a modern facility that served black children from kindergarten through the eighth grade. Segregated schools have black teachers, gave them the opportunity to work. The school opened with only six black teachers and a principal, which I just showed you. The high school in Salina remained integrated as completion of Dunbar marked the advent of segregation as early education levels. It was recognized for creative musical events. The faculty and students inspired and supported cultural development in the community. One thing with Salina, when they were the high school students, if you look at a yearbook from back in that day, all the black students were in the back of the yearbook. You know, they sat in the back of the class. We had movie theaters. We had two main movie theaters, the Vogue Movie Theater and the Fox Movie Theater. If you've ever been to Salina, there's a Stiefel concert hall, basically. And we have great acts that come through there. I mean, we had Pat Benatar, I think, was there once. But anyway, I don't know why I just thought of Pat Benatar. But we've had great acts. But back in the day, Fox Theater was the only place the blacks could go to. Vogue Theater, you weren't allowed to go there. And then the blacks would go to Fox Theater, and they would have to sit up in the balcony. And for years, that's where we always sat at. And I never understood why, when I'd go to a movie with my friends, we always sat up in the balcony, even if there was no place to, it was totally open down, until I did this research on it and found that out. Salina, we didn't have, like, blacks only signs here, whites only, but you knew. And so when I talked to the elders, they were like, we knew our place. And so Salina's a little bit different than, like, Wichita had their sit-ins, Kansas City had their sit-ins. Salina never did anything like that. The African Americans didn't. It's more of a, it was more like get along to get along. I wanted to show you this picture of this kid. His last name is Knight, and he was the first black student in the U.S. to play on a white team, and that's in Salina, Kansas. And they said that the white counterparts that he played with didn't realize the racism until they would go to other cities to play, and then they saw it. So that's what I say about kids. When they're around it, they're not looking at the, they get that from the parents, they get that from the community. They don't get that from just themselves, you know? And then I want to go over a little bit more about Robert Caldwell, because this is who I wrote my thesis on. I couldn't understand, and here's a story. We had a county commissioners meeting, and they were talking about building a new health department. And so one of the county commissioners said, and in Salina, we have city commissioners that are usually liberal, and our county commissioners are usually pretty conservative because they're out in a rural area. So they're out like in Smolin and Assyria and those places like that, really small towns. And so our county commissioner, one of them said, well, let's just in-rig it. But he said the word. And they just, people busted out laughing. They thought it was funny. Well, they had taped it. So it was, people in the community were out, you know, outraged by it. So I'm watching Jon Stewart one night, and he has the tape of, and I'm like, oh my gosh, so this is what people are going to think of my community, is this idiot. And so I was like, now how did we get a black mayor in 1970 with this kind of attitude? So that's what I wrote my thesis on. How did Salina, Kansas have an African-American mayor in 1970? How did that happen with the 4% black population? And so this is Robert Caldwell. Again, that's who our mayor was. And he was a Boy Scout leader. He had the only, he was the only black Boy Scout leader. And here's his troops. And he did a lot for our community. He taught, he was a human relations commissioner. Show you some other pictures. He taught, we have a Carver swimming pool, so we had a segregated pool. So we had a black pool and we had the white pool. And so he taught a lot of African Americans, white students, Hispanic students how to swim. There's a story behind that, and I want to go over that with you, because there was a period, it was in the news quite a bit, about people calling the police on black people swimming in their pools, especially like communal pools. And so anyway, I was like, why is there such an issue with black swimming in the pools? It has to be something more than just, I don't like black people, they need to get out of my pool. I mean, what's the significance of it? So of course I'm gonna find this paper, which is like the only one I can't find. Bear with me, please. It's highlighted. And it says swimming pools, there we go. Okay. So we had watering holes. And so the watering holes was out there by a Smoky Hill River. And people kept complaining because they kept seeing blacks and Mexicans swimming there. So they had to keep moving back so people didn't see them. And so they did have a swimming pool. It's Oakdale Park now. And but the blacks weren't allowed to swim there. And so then they weren't allowed to swim in a watering hole. They kept scooting them back, so they weren't allowed, didn't have any place to swim. So the blacks in the community went to the city commissioner, and they advocated and begged for the blacks to be able to swim at Oakdale swimming pool. And so they finally allowed that to happen, but they could only swim once a month. And after they swam, they had to drain the pond or drain the swimming pool. Well, that happened all over. And it was because they didn't want to be contaminated. So anyway, so the significance of Mr. Caldwell teaching people how to swim, and then the Carver, and I'll show you the Carver Center here in a minute, but the swimming pool that we had there, that was donated by a white person. The church, St. John's Missionary Baptist Church, was paid off by a white person. So Salina, with that, you have that small black population, but we couldn't be where we're at without people that support us. That's all across the United States, but especially small black communities. And then here's some soldiers from Camp Phillips. And this actually is soldiers from World War I. These are, and one on the your left is World War I, I believe. And then the center is World War II. We had Camp Phillips. So it's 5 miles north of Salina. Have you guys heard about Camp Phillips at all? You have? What do you know about it?
World War II,
Camp Phillips. Yep. Specifically commandeered by or directed by Roosevelt. Here's the barracks. And they built it up really, really quick. And so they held German POW soldiers. And one thing about that is we used to have a bus station, and next door to the bus station was a restaurant. And so the soldiers sometimes would take the POWs to go eat there. Well, if it was a black soldier, they would have to step outside while the POWs ate inside. So you got German soldiers and black soldiers not able to sit down and eat. And this is part of Carver Center. This is where the Black Hub was. These are all the lovely kids. And when I was showing pictures to some of the elders, they were like, yeah, that's Annie. Yeah, that's. And it was just bringing things back to life. And they were telling me all these stories. And as a historian, there's nothing like sitting with an elder and having them tell you. Oh, here's some more. And this is, again, from the Black Word Is. And these are the best pictures I could get. But you see, there's white kids. There's black kids. This is a grade school. First grade, 1919 to 1920s, 1917 to 1980s. They were integrated. Can you imagine what would have happened without segregation, where we would be right now? And thank God for desegregation, really. And thank God for Kansas. You know, we bag on Kansas so much, and I bag on Kansas, but we're not all bad. We're good people, and we've got a wonderful history. And I'm going to go ahead and end there. There's much more history of Salina, but I stopped in the 50s, basically, with desegregation. Just because it's only so much time I have. Oh, good, he clapped. This guy has a stone face. I don't know who this.
Okay, we have, I'm gonna bring the microphone around if you wanna ask questions. So,
okay, go.
Does anyone have questions? Okay, Jim.
Hi, Jim Liker. I think we've met before, maybe.
Hi, Jim.
So tell us why Salina had a black mayor in 1970 with only 4% of the population being African-American.
Sure. At that time, Robert Caldwell was teaching at Central High School. So he was the only black teacher that we had. For years, he was the only black teacher that we had in high school. So when Dunbar closed in 1955, we didn't have a black teacher until 1964. And that was Robert Caldwell. And his wife was an instructor at Marymount College. She was a dance instructor. Well, Marymount is a Catholic college. And so we have quite a bit of support with our Catholics in our community. And so the nuns went out there and supported Robert Caldwell. He was very popular with his students, so their parents supported him. He was a Boy Scout leader. He was just so involved in community, so the blacks voted for him, and whites came out and voted for him. And the way that our city government works is you elect city commissioners, so there was three that were elected. And then they choose who's the mayor. So you're not necessarily electing the mayor, you're electing the city commissioners, but they choose. So that's how that happened. So he got in with the white vote. Yes, we
Hold on.
Oh, sorry.
Can you say it again?
Has there been a black mayor since?
Yes, Dr. Trent Davis, and he's still he's not our mayor anymore. He's a city commissioner, but he was elected a few years back, and so but we've only had two. So that was just, about 2019 when he was elected, and then Mr. Caldwell back in the day. So.
So in Salina, were cemeteries segregated as well? I mean, in some communities, they were, some they weren't.
They were segregated. Gibson Hill, which is a Catholic cemetery, would bury African Americans. The main cemetery that we have is Roselawn, which at one time in my life, I was assistant funeral director and found a lease on a grave that said, "Color's not allowed." So, and then Mr. Caldwell and his family's actually buried there. And the owner was racist, but his son was not. And his son is actually a member of St. John's Missionary Baptist Church. So.
Can you talk a little bit more about redlining in Salina? What were the boundaries?
Sure. The boundaries in Salina were, and I'm sorry that I didn't bring pictures, but it's the north side of town, so we have railroad tracks where I was talking about the railroad. Yes, are you from Salina? Oh my gosh, you're the second person today I've met from Abilene. The guy that works in the cafeteria is from Abilene. What's his name, Jeremy? Jeremy from Yeah. So Pacific Street. And then, like Mr. Caldwell, he was the first African American to be able to buy a home south of Crawford Street, which is our center of town. So, since you've been in Salina, you see the condition of the north side of town. And it hasn't changed since I was a kid, and I'm not my 20s, okay?
It's a great welcome to town when you're a visitor to Salina. You've never seen it. You drive through that to get to town.
Yes. So it's like, oh, my gosh. Yeah. Oh, you want me to talk a little bit more about the redlining?
Sure.
The redlining is basically banks wouldn't give African Americans loans, especially not to buy a house south of Pacific Street. So a lot of times, like when we had the urban renewal, which is when the government commissioned local communities to go through poor communities and decide or inspect and housing that wasn't up to par, they would tear it down. And that's what happened. That's why there's not really a north end as far as significant black businesses and stuff like that, is because of that urban renewal, because they tore down homes and such and split families apart. And that's what happened all across the United States. And that was commissioned, I believe it started with Kennedy and then led on to Johnson. So, I mean, the intentions may have been good. And that's what has happened in history a lot of times. The intentions are good, but the result isn't necessarily always good. But the banks wouldn't loan money, especially on that end of town. And I have to tell you, like when I was trying to find out how many black businesses we have in the whole city of Salina, I couldn't. I went to the Chamber of Commerce, and they didn't have any numbers. They don't have any members that are black. And you know, we're a town of 50,000 people. You know, you should at least have some numbers, some type of, but it's kind of like the good old boy network. And that's how I remember was telling people, the only when I was growing up, the only African American I saw work at a bank was a teller, and that was it. And we finally, like I remember when I was growing up, I never saw like a black police officer, fireman. I didn't have a black teacher till I was in seventh grade. And when I moved to Kentucky in Louisville, I was shocked at black bus drivers, black teachers, black, I mean, it floored me, because that's not the environment that I grew up in. Yes.
Hold on, Mary.
Do you know who the Cranberries are? The band?
I do.
You look just like her. That's what it is.
If only I had that voice. So
One of the difficulties, it seems like, with rural America in general is to be able to have that cross-pollinization of everything that makes diversity great. It means that those who are in the minority have to choose to live there.
Yes.
And choose to stay there.
Yes.
Despite whatever it is that they might encounter. And do you find now that it is still difficult to attract, because it is rural America, it is rural Kansas,
yes.
And why would, you know, we knew someone who was living in a small town in, I won't say if it was Missouri or Kansas, it really doesn't matter, but this was a liberal person who felt that she was the last bastion of liberal-minded thinkers.
Right.
In the society that she knew,
uh-huh.
And finally, she was a school teacher, and finally left and came to Kansas City when she got engaged to someone
yeah.
who lives here.
Yeah.
And I feel bad for the fact that, you know, as soon as you leave, that voice isn't there anymore.
That's right.
And so, regardless of which way you feel, how you want to vote, if you don't have a difference of fill in the blank,
right.
Then it's very siloed. And so, is Salina making any aggressive, assertive efforts to attract minority populations? If so, what?
No. Not that I know of. And I've been asking this question, like, why aren't we doing that? In fact, we had a 4% black population. Now it's nearing 3%. So you're talking about 1,800 black people. And the young people are leaving. Because job opportunities, you know, you have someone that has a degree in engineering or something like that. They can't get a job. It's hard enough to get a job in Salina for people with higher education anyway. But and also, sometimes people want to be around people that they have a familiar with and that they can relate to. And when... like it's like when I'll go into a grocery store and I'll see another black person, I'm like, hey, how you doing? Whoa, there's two of us here. We've made it. But no. And at one time, and another time, I'll go from 1950 to current. But we had a Schilling Air Force Base, and so we had quite a few African Americans that ended up either staying or moving back. And so that's where we actually had a split. So we had the people that were service kids, and that's how my family met. And then we had the locals that came up from Kentucky and Louisiana and those places. And so we had two high schools, so the blacks basically at first they had to go to Central High, and then eventually they moved on to go into South, which was on the south end of town. But we had people coming in and coming back, but not anymore. And it's just, there's not, like we've got one main black church. You know, there's just not that diversity. You want to be able to prosper and to move up. And then you're also talking about, like you said, rural America. So it's not like, you know, if you want to be an attorney or something like that, you got to move to Topeka, or you got to come to Kansas City, or, you know, we've got private colleges, and we got the Kansas State now, or technical college. But and so they used to attract quite a few college students. And when I was going to college, I went to Bethany, which is Lindsborg, which is right outside. And that's a whole other story. As a Swedish community. It's a good school, though. I used to say that's where I got my culture diversity, just because they attract people from, like, the Sudan and El Salvador and different places like that. But it was shocking to me, actually, when I joined the military, you know, and I was able to be around people that, I'm really probably telling too much of my own information, but I'm biracial, so I was raised by my white family, so I never really was... had that relationship so much with the black community until I got older, especially until I came back from the military, and that's when I started being really involved in it. But there was a separation because I didn't live on the north end of town. And so when I went to school, there was my brother and I, and we were the only two kids, and we were biracial. And this is back in the 70s and 80s, where there weren't that many of us that are biracial. There's quite a few biracial kids. There's almost more biracial kids than just black kids in Salina now. And that's what was shocking to me when I moved down to Louisville and stuff like that, because there were so many black couples and such, and we didn't have that in Salina. So it was like, oh my gosh. It was just a culture shock. Food, dress, music. You know, just music. We had a country channel, you know, but we got to listen to Michael Jackson, sometimes Prince. But you know, that's you know, so it, there was no culture diversity.
Anyone else? All right, I think I'll ask the last one then, Marie.
Okay.
Tell us where we might hear more from you, or how will we get to hear more of these wonderful stories that you've talked about today?
Well, just contact Ty Edwards. She will get you in touch with me.
Yeah, true.
I didn't put any information. I just figured it would just be easier if you don't mind.
Yeah, that's fine. But you've also done presentations at like the Salina.
Oh,
Public
Salina
Library.
Public Library. I've done some things on Eleanor Roosevelt, which is one of my idols. Richard Nixon. It's not one of my idols, but I find him interesting. The Temperance Movement, Granny Hatchett. I think was her name. Oh, Carrie Nation, if you guys ever heard of Carrie Nation. And what else I have? Queen Victoria, yeah, relationship with her mother, things like that.
And Caldwell,
that's who I wrote my thesis on. So as a historian, I'm sure that you guys know, sometimes you're just driving down the street and you're like, why is that there? I think I'm going to go research that. And then you're like, oh, other people might like to hear about that too. And that's how this happened. That's how this started with Robert Caldwell. Was like, and the county commissioner. Like, how in the heck did that happen?
All right, well, let's think. Oh, you have one more?
Sure. Are there any descendants of Robert Caldwell living in Salina or in Kansas now?
No. He had a son who passed away. His wife, of course, has passed on. He's passed on. And he had a daughter that passed away, and he's got a daughter that lives in Iowa. So, and she comes back, like we're getting ready to have a anniversary to celebrate Dunbar. And so that'll be in November. Yeah, and so she'll be there for that. But that's it, yeah.
I'm sorry. When you spoke with the elders to learn the culture and the history, was any of the conversation recorded by a cassette tape or video? Any of your interaction with them, is it on record anywhere?
The only record that I have where I tape recorded some of it in Salina, but a lot of people I had to talk to over the telephone because they had retired with their family. In fact, there was one gal that she was in her 90s, and I had to wait for her to get a magnifying glass so she could so it is, when I say primary source, I'm talking primary source. Yeah.
All right. Well, let's thank Marie for speaking with us today. And thank you very much.